Minneapolis, St. Paul, The Fan.
If you want to chime in on what's happening with your favorite KFAN shows, you can make your voice heard on the Brad Sean Bryant KFAN text line. Let us know what you have to say by texting your message to 64686. That's 64686. Standard text message and data rates apply.
Section discussion online and elsewhere around the water cooler about a testimony given by the presidents of Harvard, MIT, and Penn. This was at a congressional hearing on anti-Semitism. I'm not so sure I always feel that school presidents should be required exactly clear on how those decisions are made. But let's leave that aside for the moment. The reaction to their inability to answer a simple question, does calling for the genocide of Jews violate your university's code of conduct or rules regarding bullying or harassment, has gotten a lot of attention. And I saw one of the Twitter smart Alex or ex smart Alex suggest that the presidents didn't give good answers, but they were right to not answer categorically. There is no quote unquote genocide exception to the First Amendment in America. Unlike many countries, you can say, quote, Hitler was right, end quote. Either campuses tolerate First Amendment speech or they don't. And anybody who listens to this show knows that I've tried to be fairly consistent with that particular position. That's very different than saying those sorts of positions aren't heinous or worthy of a great deal of derision and savagery. But even if you want to accept the premise from that tweeter, there's a couple of, I think, very significant issues here that are, shall we say, problematic for those school presidents. The first, I think, would be an inability to call it out, even if you say by the standards that we have set for free speech, peace exchange, we're going to allow it, but that doesn't mean we're necessarily interested in conveying the wrong message and endorsing it. The greatest comeback was from, I don't think this was from Biden, but a Biden spokesperson, Andrew Bates. This was last night, I think, in reaction to the uproar regarding the embarrassing performances by those three school presidents. Quote, "It's unbelievable that this needs to be said. Calls for genocide are monstrous and antithetical to everything we represent as a country. Any statements that advocate for the systematic murder of Jews are dangerous and revolting, and we should all stand firmly against them on the side of human dignity and the most basic values that ignite us as Americans." Doesn't seem to be that difficult a statement to make, unless, apparently, you are a great academician or a great university president getting, you know, hammered at one of these congressional hearings, in which case you become suddenly, how do you say it, very, very theoretical and very philosophical. And I'm not the first to say this, but leaving aside whether those sorts of comments should be allowed if you cling to the First Amendment, even at a university, what would the reaction from those same individuals, those three school presidents and others, what would the reaction be to a similar genocide question about, let's say, Black Americans, transgender students? Is there any chance in hell that the university presidents would have been as philosophical and theoretical or even constitutional in their reaction? or would it have been slightly more visceral? You know, and I know the answers to that question. They would have spoken in a very similar, I think, to the way that the Biden spokesman spoke. And in fact, the way the president has spoken through much of this. That shouldn't be that difficult to figure out. Then there's the other major problem. This is, I think, actually a bigger problem, which we've talked about before, but it's reared its head again on this occasion. Once again, the hypocrisy, the disingenuousness of finding religion on the issue of protecting speech, even heinous, highly objectionable speech in many universities, including this three, is a bleeping joke. It's absurd. Check the records of these and how many other schools that we've discussed over the course of the last, feels like we've been talking about this for the better part of a decade, regarding disfavored speech. How many times have those universities hidden behind what they now think they have a right to hide behind, which is, well, we encourage differences of opinion, and we're not going to stand in the way of discourse, even discourse that we might not like. That might be believable, and I would even say it's the favorite course if there was any consistency with it. But there is no consistency with it. The examples are endless. I'll give you a couple, even involving a few of these particular schools. As somebody put it, if the idea of the allowing speech, even if we find it objectionable, if there had been a consistency with that, if there had been a willingness to hold your nose and stand by that, you might be able to convince me, but there has been none. I'm reminded, for example, the Harvard president, this was before she was president. I remember this story because we talked about it. She was instrumental in ousting a Harvard law professor named Ronald Sullivan from an administrative post after he served on Harvey Weinstein's defense team. He's doing his job, being a criminal defense lawyer. Now, what was the reason for her position on that? What was the reason for why Harvard went down that particular cancellation mode? Well, it wasn't because the presidents have kind of theoretically, when they spoke yesterday, they're trying to put on the basis of, well, if you are harassing or intimidating a single, in this case, I guess you say Jewish student, that would be over the line. But the implication is if you decide to make a broader, more generalized statement of genocide, just the statement, that would be more protected. Now, how do you reconcile that with a decision made to oust this particular law professor, esteemed law professor? Because that wasn't about necessarily endangering any single student. That was suggesting that the statement that it is made by allowing him to defend a person this heinous is a dangerous message, a concerning message for all, presumably you could say students, but certainly female students. So there's no consistency to even their theoretical attempt to defend what they say they're defending now regarding the genocide cries, when the history goes back time and again that when they get enough pushback, they say we have to stand for our students, for their rights to feel safe. Apparently not Jewish students. By the way, not Israeli students. Students who go to these schools who are of the Jewish faith, who may have absolutely nothing to do with Israel whatsoever. Go back to 2021, MIT. Guy by the name of Dorian Abbott, a geophysicist, University of Chicago. He's invited to speak about climate change. He gets axed. You know why? his comments about affirmative action offended graduate students. So who are we kidding here about the idea that now these presidents have decided, after all of this time and all of these other examples of having no hesitation to pound away at disfavored speech, troubling speech, now it's, no, we're much more philosophical than that. We have to accept all sorts of different points of views when in the past they've had no difficulty doing exactly that. So it's, again, in my perfect world, as sick a commentary is as calling for genocide, is that let as much speech go, even heinous speech as you can, and try to fight it with more speech. What the speech codes say at these various schools, I don't have all that inside information, because there are speech codes that are factored in. Sometimes they are tested in the courts. Sometimes they stand the muster. Sometimes they don't. Sometimes they get knocked down as well. But I can't with a straight face listen to these clowns pretend to be standing for something so noble as they're now pretending to stand for, when for decades they have curled up in the fetal position and caved in depending on which group is coming at them with the complaint. Let's be honest. That's what this is about. And if that's the way you make those decisions, you're not noble. You're not about any larger cause. You're about power. You are simply 100% about power. We'll get to a couple of texts. Prepare for a 4:30 visit with
the Fan.
Door is now open for the holidays. You can find your favorite Fan merch and show your pride through our exclusive collection. Shop now through this Sunday and join the Fan Frenzy, KFAN.com, keyword store.
I see you almost every night. I watch you dance every dance. Man, I love left and right.
Get to some text regarding the kerfuffle involving three university presidents who testified yesterday on Capitol Hill. Bradshaw and Brian KFAN text line is open, 646-86. Where do we go? Get to a couple of them early. We try to do kind of a cross-section of opinion. Some agreeing with me, some not so much. 651 texter, this is a cringeworthy segment. Ron writes, what about the Jews calling for and actively performing an ethnic cleansing of Palestinians, genocide? So this is the game that's played, is that you don't really deal with this particular. We're allowed on this show, I think, we try to take each issue one at a time. Now, they overlap sometimes, and they're complicated sometimes. But my the surest tip off I have that the texter doesn't really want to address the issues discussed is he changes the subject. Doesn't necessarily mean that subject does not have worthiness, but he changes the subject from what is the subject at hand. That's a game that's been played forever and ever and ever. Dan, I think the biggest problem here is that the only time we've ever had a problem with any of this is when it's regard to Jews. No one cares if anyone says we need to genocide all white people. People say that all the time now, but saying that it's specifically not okay to say it about Jews is the problem. Dan, the question isn't whether expressing violence towards Jews is constitutional or not. The question is, does making threats towards Jews on campus and those threats being made by students towards students, does that violate the school's policy? Absolutely true. The question, he goes on to say, comes obviously the answer is yes. In fact, students on these campuses have been punished for saying that there are only, quote, male and female sexes, reasoning that stating true, quote, facts was indeed hate speech. This goes back to inconsistencies of when you decide to use the power that you believe is given you in the name of protecting students and when you don't. And you're not going to tell me with a straight face that students are automatically being more harmed, put in more dangerous positions by letting somebody speak on campus on one issue who happens on another issue to question some of the directives DEI related. A conversation that we've had and that people should be allowed, even if they believe in the concept, may not believe in the way various universities go about carrying out those initiatives. You can't with a straight face say that folks calling for the genocide of an entire people is less dangerous than one speaker who might question some of the bullet points on a given DEI policy or DEI policy in general. That's game, set, match. And we have endless examples of it. I was reminded by one of our texters, we had the nonsense here. Was it McAllister? Where was it? Where the teacher got in trouble, got excoriated by the school. School dumped on her, claimed that, well, they had the fact that we didn't renew her outside contract had nothing to do with the decision she made showing images of the Prophet Muhammad. Again, we have no... Universities have to varying degrees over a decade have made it very, very clear that they're making it up as they go along on this issue. And sadly, but maybe importantly, it was fully exposed in a way yesterday that actually had, interestingly, righties and lefties annoyed with the very sort of academic answers that came from the university president, suddenly turning this into some kind of a constitutional law exercise when their histories indicate they've never been that concerned with that side of it. Another text I wanted to get to regarding, sorry, Matt, like what the president said is cringeworthy, not the segment itself, although I guess it could be both. Dan, you're right on the money. They, as in big college mucky mucks, are all frauds. Every one of them. That's Richard from Stillwater. Let me make something really clear. I'm a big college guy. I am not anti-university in general. I loved the university I went to. I loved the experience I had there. I think I love all of it. I love academics. And so I'm not one of those guys who's anti-college, anti-knowledge, or thinks it's all a waste of time. I don't think it's a waste of time. You could say, could it be cheaper? Could it be better targeted in different ways? Yeah, but don't get me wrong. When I'm ripping what these three university presidents said, that's not me saying I hate all these guys who live in their ivory tower. I like the ivory tower. I'm not anti-ivory tower. So that might annoy some people even more. I don't know. But what I do hate is hypocrisy, and that was what was exposed once again. It's not news to most of us who've been paying attention to this for a while, but a subplot of the entire Israeli-Palestinian conflict as it has played out especially since October 7th, is the cracks within, quite frankly, the left side of the aisle of the political spectrum. When it comes to the importance of again, quote unquote, protecting constituents, and we've learned the hard way that they don't. Many of these folks who have been lecturing us on this issue over and over the last several years about these difficult conversations we've had, they've been exposed as frauds because they're not. If they were consistent with it, they wouldn't have such difficulty answering these particular questions, or they already would have had a better track record that would have made it easier for them to stick with the notion of tough speech, obscene speech, dangerous speech. But our job, we believe at university, is to expose kids to a lot of different things, and we're not going to get in the position of necessarily trying to chill it. You can't do that with a straight face when you've been chilling it as long as many of them indeed have. Thanks for the common sense during the segment. Been a loyal listener since the Chad and Barrero days. That goes back a long ways. And this may be the most important and best segment you've ever done. That's Dana. I appreciate the kind words as well. And I also do also even appreciate some of the savagery that has come our way. Can we just say stupid? It scares me. We're sending our kids to be taught by these geniuses. This country has no chance. I don't know if the country has no chance. I just know that this is too big an issue to sort of ignore. And I don't even think it should be partisan. I really don't. I think this issue should not be all that partisan. But sadly, that's the way a lot of people are going to look at it, especially because it was basically Republicans who were attempting to put the school presidents in the meat grinder yesterday. And maybe that's even part of the reason why they answered the questions the way they did. We've talked about this forever. The game we're in politically now, it's a game of, I'm not going to give any sustenance to my enemy. So if those school presidents look at those questioners as their enemy, then no matter what they're thinking, they're not going to give them the red meat that they think that they are asking for in the questions they're asking. And it's part of the reason we can never really get to anything. Because if your only goal is to not give sustenance to the enemy, you have no interest in even honestly and completely following the story.
Bumper on the Fan. It's time for another edition of Mace in Your Face. Now, along with college football immortality, Glen Mason,
yeah.
Here's Dan Barrero.
He's brought to us by our good friends at Carey Limo, as always. Mace in my face, but not in studio. It'll have to be by telephone today. He joins us via the Connecticut Water Systems hotline. As we welcome you back to the festivities, you'll be shocked to learn that Guardsy is off again today.
Not surprising at all. I'm shocked when he's in person there.
That's it.
I mean, it's kind of, now you see him, now you don't.
Yeah, he's doing Golden Gopher women's basketball tonight. They're playing in Lexington, Kentucky against the Gopher women, taking on the Kentucky Wildcats on one of our sister stations this very evening. Let's not, back into it. Let's get into it right from the start, because you and I have not talked either on air or off regarding this particular subject. Controversial weekend in college football. The unexpected takes place. Alabama beats Georgia. And then the door opens to, looks like there's a chance at least one team that is worthy of the top four and playing for the national championship is going to be on the outside looking in. The committee ultimately chooses Florida State as the team that is left, without a chance to play for the national championship. I am not offended by it. A lot of people in college football are. Are you among those?
Well, I don't know about offended by it. I'm not surprised by it whatsoever. You know, all the speculation that was taking place before the selection show, and I happened to be talking to some of my guys, so to speak, and I said, I'm telling you guys, they're not going to have a college football playoff without an SEC team.
Right.
And they're saying, well, who would you leave out? You can't leave Washington out. You can't leave Michigan out. And Texas beat Alabama the regular season. I said, I'm telling you, Alabama's going to be in. Florida State's going to be out. In fact, I'm going to tell you, Dan, if Oregon would have beat Washington, then Washington would have been out, Oregon been out, maybe Florida State would have been, but Alabama still would have been in.
Interesting. Well, here's the $64,000 question. I believe, and look, if I'm Florida State, if I'm coaching that team, if I'm ADing at that university, if I'm the president of the university, or if I'm playing, I'm bitter, I'm frustrated. We won every game. What else do you want us to do? It's not our fault somebody gets hurt. But as I understand it, Mace, in the fine print that allegedly the committee goes by, it right out in black and white says that voters can indeed, you know, I guess, allow for or factor in the availability of key players. And so, to me, if you open that door, you shouldn't be surprised that somebody's going to go through it. And if that bothers people, then I would say take that out. Literally say, it's academic now because we're going to more teams. But if we weren't, take that out of whatever the fine print is in your constitution, right? But if it's in there, I just don't think it's that surprising, even if it's, in a sense, quite unfair to the players who played, that they're going to say, well, we are trying to go for what we think at this point are the most competitive matchups. Because you and I both know, if Florida State was in and they get killed by 40, some of the same people were saying they should be allowed to be in would be saying, well, what kind of matchup was that? That was a waste of time. That wasn't very good TV. So I just don't think people can have it both ways. What do you think?
Well, first of all, you're saying take it out like everybody was part of the contract that was written.
Well, yeah.
I don't think that's what it is. I think college football playoff, they had some awful good lawyers and said, make sure you word this, that we have as much maneuvering as we possibly can. And, you know, the silent partner in all this stuff is the TV people. They pay a lot of money to put this on, and they want to make sure the participants are going to be in this game, turn on as many TV sets as possible. And when you have Michigan, the winningest college football program in the history of college football, playing Alabama, that is the hottest name in modern day history, you don't think that's not going to turn a lot of TV sets on? And I'm just going to say this, okay, to your scenario. Let's just hypothetically say that Michigan beats the living dog out of Alabama.
Right, yeah.
What is everybody going to say then?
Yeah, they are.
You know, who knows?
Yeah, that's true. That's the game that's played, which I think is silly in a way, because it should be more about, okay, who do you think is most deserving to be there, more than whether, well, it turns out that was a waste. That we wasted our time on that. I think there's too much conversation about it. If you're in that room, what four teams would you have picked?
If I was in that room, well, first of all, you know, I'm going to look at everybody, me included, are going to be focused that Alabama beat Georgia. You're going to forget about the week before that against a very poor Auburn team, they needed a Hail Mary to win the game. And then earlier in the year, when they had everybody there, they had come from behind against, I think it was South Florida, and that's when their quarterback got benched, you know? So I'm not making it that was an easy, easy decision, but you got to remember something. I'm a coach, and you've heard me say a million times that I think that football is the greatest team game that's ever been invented. So now all of a sudden you have an undefeated team minus one player, and it's not like he just got hurt in that game. He has been hurt for a couple games. And now you're saying, well, you're undefeated team, but you don't get to go because one of your guys isn't there. I have a hard time with that.
You didn't tell me who the four teams are that you would have picked.
I told you my thing. I don't know.
Come on.
I wasn't I probably, I'll be honest with you, I probably would have put Florida State in there.
You would have done it.
They deserve it.
Okay.
Yeah, I think I would have.
I can respect that. I can see where that might be the case. And then at whose expense then? Who's out?
Alabama.
Now, what can you make the argument that Texas shouldn't have been as automatic? Because I get it. Texas beat Alabama. That was much earlier in the season. But Texas also on its schedule had one could argue, a much worse loss. Didn't they lose to somebody pretty mediocre as well?
Oklahoma.
Yeah. So,
their rival game.
You know, we're back to, I guess, the idea that this is why people wanted 12 teams, right? The assumption is.
Yeah, but okay, hold on. Now I'm going to just tell you something.
All right.
So now we go to 12 games next year. Are you telling me that there isn't going to be controversy who the top four guys are that get a bye?
Yeah, there will be.
The next team, how they're located, who gets to play a home game and an away game, and then all of a sudden, whoever that team 13 is, there'll be argument there. It is not going to be not controversial.
Well, how do we fix it?
Well, I guess you could do like some people think about this college football playoff and make it like March Madness where they have 64 or 68 teams. That ain't going to happen, I'm going to tell you. But I can tell you this, Dan. There is a college football playoff system year-long right now. The regular season really, really matters. You know that. If a team loses with four teams, normally you say, they're done. They're gone, okay? Now, in college basketball, that's not the case. The regular season doesn't matter that much. You know, they can lose a game here, there, a couple games, and as long as you get in the tournament, you got a chance, you know, to run the table. But in football, you can't play that many games. So, you know, there for a long time, the president says they didn't want to do a playoff for four teams. That was going to be it. Now way are we going to expand it. And now we've gone to 12. The more you expand, the more it hurts the regular season. And the hypocrisy of this whole thing, everybody is so concerned about injuries in the sport of football. Well, let's just add more games.
Yeah.
I can tell you, as a 35-year veteran of coaching, there's a lot more injuries exponentially in games than there ever is in practice.
Yeah. Well, you know me. I'm enough of a traditionalist that I loved the way it was set up. But, I mean, that just wasn't going to fly any longer. People, they think it's a little bit, to me, like replay. They think they're going to get everything resolved and all their questions answered with a playoff system. But to your point, they're really not, because as you say, now the battle will be not, you know, whether you don't have to worry about whether a team that's ranked fifth is going to miss the chance to play for the national championship because there's 12 teams. But now the battle will be over byes, because byes are a big issue, right? I mean, they obviously give those teams a huge advantage as well. So there's never going to be we're never going to get the certainty that people think we're going to get. Which is why I was fine with the regular season. But you know, and I know there was going to be at some point they're going to figure out there's too much money at stake here that they were ever going to go back to. Well, let's just go back to the old system.
Well, you hit the nail on the head. First of all, the people that are making the decisions, if you think that the primary concern is what's good for the game, what's good for the players, what's good for the fan, no, that is not it. It's how can we generate more money off this whole thing? And when you have the TV, and I'm not saying it's wrong, it's just that it's business. When you have the people behind the scenes, being the network people, whoever putting this thing on, throwing more money at it, getting everybody's appetite, that's what's going to be driving the whole thing. And the bad thing about it, you've seen the college bowl system as we know it really suffer over the couple of years. What do you think is going to happen when you go to these 12-team playoffs? You know, you've seen key players from these top programs when they think they're going to be in the college football playoff, and they're not, and they go to a bowl, which is a really high-class, top-tier bowl, and the top players are saying, nah, I'm not going to play in it. What do you think is going to happen in the long run then?
I got a couple texts from people saying they think Georgia should be in. 29 straight wins and a 3-point loss only? Come on. So, I mean,
let me tell you that, and I understand that argument, okay? But then you have the argument where you're going to put Georgia and Alabama both in, two SEC teams, and leave an undefeated team out. I think the uproar would be unbelievable.
All right, let's get
I guess you can go back and forth. Is Georgia more deserving than Alabama? Like I've always said, Dan, if you're going to lose early. Don't lose late.
All right. The story broke yesterday also that I want to get your reaction to that you might have seen. NCAA President Charlie Baker says his proposal to allow the most highly resourced schools in Division I to pay athletes directly via name, image, and likeness deals and use a trust fund is just a starting point as he tries to shift the association to be more proactive than reactive. Here's his quote. We need to be able to anticipate where conversations are going and to try to get this big, huge, diverse committee with 2,000 members, like, oh my God, to a place where they're talking about stuff that's common and not just responding and reacting to other people's agendas. This was at some appearance, an appearance at the Sports Business Journal's Intercollegiate Athletic Forum. So In effect, did you read about the proposal? The details about it?
Okay, I read about it, and I read about it in the Wall Street Journal today.
Okay, so what does it mean? How does it fundamentally change things? Is it a good idea? Is it fool's gold? What do you make of it?
Well, first of all, I think he's late to the dance, so to speak. You know, this has been coming for years and years and years, and the only reason the NCAA, him being leaders, getting involved now, they've lost control because all the money's going to the players. And I'm sure that, you know, a lot of the institutions are saying, geez, this money's getting shifted away from us. Now, here's what I take on it, okay? I witnessed this firsthand with the shoe deals. It used to be that no coaches had any shoe deals, no universities had shoe deals. What happened to the key players, the shoe people, would go right to the player, you know, and say, gee, where are shoes? You're playing in the Rose Bowl, you're playing... You know, we'll give you some money on the side or give you some apparel to put our shoes on. You got the drift? Well, then all of a sudden they went to the coaches, and it started in basketball, but in football it happened in the year, right about 1980 or 81. They went and cut a deal with the head football coach. I wasn't a head football coach then. And they said, listen, we'll give you X number of dollars if you get your team to wear our shoes. Well, the coach got the money, and then the players were forced to wear that particular shoe, and they were cut out of the deal. And then that became more lucrative. So what had happened? Then the universities cut the deal with the shoe people, and they got the big contract. And in essence, it had nothing to do with the coach. But when you see these big contracts now, a lot of times when they're broken down, you'll see, well, X number of dollars are coming from the university, but they're getting the money from the shoe people. You get my drift?
I do.
But the coach has no bearing out of it. So when I read that whole thing, I said, oh, yeah, here they're going to take control of the NIL money, and they're going to control it much like they did the shoe money.
All right, and isn't it even though going to make the has and have-nots deal worse in terms of we know the schools have the money? Doesn't that just exacerbate that whole issue regarding – the difference between the folks who, you know, who've got the big bankrolls and those who don't? The programs I'm talking about.
I don't think there's any doubt about it. You know, there's, you know, and again, don't compare football and basketball because there's a lot more moving parts. You only have 12 or 13 players in basketball. But the thing about it is, what has really changed fundamentally in modern day football? The good teams are the good teams. The people that have the built-in halves are there. They get the best players all the time. They have the more resources. They got the best facilities. And year in, year out, yeah, I know there's a couple exceptions, but most often they're there, and everybody else is a second-class citizen.
All right, so I'm assuming you heard the news that the Gophers have a new quarterback that they got to the portal. I think he comes out of New Hampshire. I assume you've never seen him play. Know very little about him. He's got, you know, had really gaudy numbers. But in general, based on your experience, how likely is it that an FCS guy, you know, who's played a completely different level, can come into a conference like the Big Ten and make that jump? Is it impossible? Is it highly unlikely? Has the college football landscape changed enough where you could say, well, no, that's very, very possible? What are the odds that a guy can make that kind of a jump?
I would say the odds are not good. You know, I mean, it can happen. Mm-hmm. Don't get me wrong. You know, every Sunday when you watch pro football and you see the guys that are playing, they're not all coming from the major conferences. Most of them are, though. But in saying that, and he might be great. I don't know. I've never seen him play. But if I was a Gopher fan, I'd probably be a lot more excited if Kyle McCord, who at Ohio State jumped in the portal and was announcing he was going to Minnesota, let's say. You know, I would think your chance of having a significant upgraded quarterback would be greater there than this young guy. And I wish him all the best of luck where he's coming from. But I wouldn't be put my bottom dollar on it.
All right, I'm going to ask you to be the great prognosticator here. We're going to have time to talk about the games themselves, but I want you to prognosticate on another issue. And I want you to use 0 to 10 as your guide, 0 being absolutely zero chance, obviously, 10 being a lock cinch certainty. Jim Harbaugh will coach the University of Michigan football again in 2024. 0 to 10.
Here I go. I mean, I get the crystal ball out.
Yeah.
I would say six.
Okay, so a little better than average,
and
you think,
and
James?
I'm saying that I would have rated it higher if the reports that I heard a year ago that he, in fact, was in discussion with the Vikings, I was shocked then if that was true, that he would even get involved in talking to a pro club unless he definitely had an offer on the table. But if he talked to him, there must be an interest there.
Yeah, and, well, it's interesting because allegedly, he and Kevin Warren didn't get along great when he was running the Big Ten, but there are a lot of rumors about that the Bears are going to make another move. They're going to want, he's going to want to bring in, Warren's going to want to bring in his own guy. And I don't know, Mace, over the years, I've just learned if that morality is out the window at the pro level, that if you're a desperate franchise and you are really, really hungry for believing that it can turn and you can become a viable franchise again, other than, I think, murdering people, and even then, I'm not even sure that would get in the way. I think a lot of these teams would say, I don't care what happened in college. If I think Jim Harbaugh gives us the best chance to get serious as a pro franchise, I'm going to hire him. What do you think?
I would agree with you, but I just wouldn't pin it on pro football. I can't be the only one that was in shock that Arkansas hired Bobby Petrino as the offensive coordinator.
Yes. Yeah.
After a couple of years ago, they fired him because of all the stuff that went on. I was just in shock.
I think you're right about that as well. Did Michigan, Iowa, nothing, I assume, surprised you about that one? I mean, honestly, we laid out the numbers a couple of days ago. Obviously, the Big Ten West never won. 0-10, the record, and the average margin of victory was 20 points, Mace. Just not a good look.
Well, I you know, and you and I had discussion, I'm sure, on air or not. When they made the East and West division as a coach, I thought that was the most ridiculous thing they ever did. On the East, you had three marquee teams in Ohio State, Michigan, and Penn State. And on the West, the closest thing you had to a marquee team was Nebraska, and they haven't been a marquee team since God knows when. So it wasn't shocking, but the outcome of that Iowa-Michigan game wasn't surprising. But I saw where Phil Parker, their defensive coordinator, won the Frank Broyles Assistant Coach of the Year. He should have been the assistant coach of the decade, I want to tell you. The way they played defense with that offense, and you know the old saying, the best defense is a good offense. He had no offense.
Yeah.
The job he did was unbelievable.
That's a great point that, you know, that he did well, but the extra strain that's put on a defense when it literally is getting no help and sometimes hindrance from an offense that's either giving up the ball or not moving it or punting, 10, 12, 15 times a game. That is when you know you got a guy who's doing a good job defensively. That much is indeed for sure.
I think they had more punting yards than they had offensive yards this year.
That's about right. Well,
but I could tell you this: the best job he did, from a guy's experience, what he had to do mentally with those defensive kids and the defensive coaches, because I'm sure every Saturday they're playing great defense, and every time the offense went out there three and out, they're shaking their heads, but he kept them going.
Thank you, my friend. We'll chat next week.
Great. Thank you.
Good stuff from Glen Mason, courtesy of our good friends at Carey Limo. Mace not in studio this week. I'm not sure if he's going to be back in studio next week or not, but he'll stay with us throughout the rest of the college football season. And now, of course, postseason. Kessler will join at about 5:30 today, but we've got top five at five, which will include what?
We'll dive back into KOC's quarterback decision, and we'll remind you that this town